Long QT syndrome is characterized by prolonged QT interval on 12-lead ECG that can induce a polymorphic ventricular tachycardia known as TORSADES de Pointes that in its turn can progress to ventricular fibrillation. Clinically, TORSADES de Pointes can produce syncope or even sudden cardiac death. The diagnostic criteria is a prolongation of corrected QT interval greater than or equal to 480 milliseconds. Or a long QT syndrome risk score greater than or equal to 3 points. Long QT syndrome can be congenital and acquired. The congenital long QT syndrome can be grouped as follows: autosomal dominant and autosomal recessive. In its turn, autosomal dominant can be divided into group without extracardiac manifestation, which includes long QT syndrome type 1, which accounts approximately 35% from all congenital long QT syndromes, type 2, which accounts 30%, and type 3, which accounts 10% from all congenital long QT syndromes. Another group of autosomal dominant long QT syndrome is long QT syndrome with extracardiac manifestation, which includes Andersen-Tawil syndrome or long QT syndrome type 7, that is characterized by periodic paralysis, cardiac arrhythmia, and physical abnormalities. Another congenital long QT syndrome with extracardiac manifestation is Timothy syndrome, or long QT syndrome type 8, which is characterized by prolonged QT, syndactyly, cardiac malformations, autism spectrum disorder, and dysmorphism. The last group is autosomal recessive congenital long QT syndrome, which is represented by Jervell and Larger-Nielse syndrome, that is characterized by both extreme QT prolongation and congenital deafness. So, as a result, long QT syndrome type 1, type 2, and type 3 together account for approximately 75% of clinically defined long QT syndromes. This video about long QT syndrome type 1. Congenital long QT syndrome type 1 is caused by genetic defect of KCNQ1 gene, which encoded potassium slow channel performing alpha protein, that called KV71. So normally, KCNQ1 gene coded KV71 protein of potassium slow channel, which in its turn provides outward potassium slow current. Therefore, if gene is defected, protein that is coded by this gene is defected too. As a result, we have loss of function of this protein as a decreasing of potassium slow current. This type of mutations is called loss of function mutations. For better understanding, let's briefly remind normal ventricular action potential. You can skip it by using the time codes. Cells that are not excited has resting membrane potential or phase 4 of action potential. When propagated impulses comes from pacemaker, the level of membrane potential reaches the threshold for sodium channel activation and phase 0, that also known as depolarization, begins. Sodium currents depolarizes the cell to positive level of membrane potential, that around plus 10 mV. Following rapid phase 0, a brief current of initial repolarization during phase 1 returns the membrane potential to approximately 0 mV. It is caused by short-lasting outward potassium channel activation. The next phase is phase 2, that is also known as plateau phase. This phase is relatively long, is mediated by the balance between inward calcium and sodium currents and outward potassium currents. Calcium current flows through the special L-type calcium channels. Outward potassium current is represented by activation of potassium slow channels. These potassium slow channels activate slowly following the phase 0 and increases gradually during the action potential plateau phase. Slow channels are formed by coassembly of the channel performing alpha protein that called KV71, which is coded by KCNQ1 gene. and with a small protein that called MinK that is encoded by KCNE1 gene. Current that is generated by potassium slow channel is small and may even be absent in normal ventricular myocardium, particularly at long cycle length. For example, in case of bradycardia develops. It assumes more importance as heart rate increases or during sympathetic stimulation, both of which increase the magnitude of this current and cause acceleration of repolarization. Also, sympathetic stimulation increases inward calcium current through the L-type calcium channel. A small fraction of the total sodium current that has provided the zero phase also persists during the plateau phase and called late sodium current. The next phase is phase 3 or repolarization, which are provided by different outward potassium currents. The first current that is responsible for termination of the action potential plateau phase is rapid potassium current. Rapid potassium channel activates relatively rapidly and maintains significant outward current during phase 3 of action potential. Potassium slow outward channel are also active during the third phase of action potential. The last outward current that is involved in terminal part of repolarization is the inward rectifier potassium current. This channel can work in both outward and inward direction, which depends on the action potential value and action potential phase. But in the terminal part of repolarization, this channel provides outward potassium current. Phase 3 completes the action potential cycle, with the return to rest in phase 4, preparing the cell to the next stimulus or depolarization. There are two important ion exchangers, sodium-potassium pump, which moves 3 sodium ions out from the cell. In exchange for 2 potassium ions that moves into the cell. Sodium-potassium pump requires energy from ATP splitting. Another exchanger is sodium-calcium exchanger that moves 1 calcium ion in exchange for 3 sodium ions. This exchanger can work in both outward and inward direction, depends on situation. Also should be noted that sympathetic stimulation increases inward direction of sodium-calcium exchanger work when 3 sodium ion enters the cell in exchange for 1 calcium ion that moves out from the cell. So in normal myocardium, potassium slow channel provides acceleration of repolarization and as a result QT interval shortening during the sympathetic stimulation. In first action potential, just after sympathetic stimulation onset, potassium slow channel is only little active. The QT interval and corrected by the heart rate QT interval remain in normal range. In second action potential with heart rate acceleration, activity of potassium slow channel is higher. QT interval and corrected QT interval becomes shorter. During the following heart rate acceleration, the activity of potassium slow channel becomes even higher than in previous one, which provides the maintaining of the QT interval and corrected QT interval in normal range. So, as a result of heart rate acceleration, QT interval becomes shorter. In case of congenital long QT syndrome type 1, loss of function mutation of potassium slow channel leads to repolarization slowdown in resting state. But also, the repolarization duration in resting state can be normal, in approximately 25% of cases. In its turn, repolarization slowdown leads to increase in both QT and corrected QT, for example 500 and 559 milliseconds respectively, that characterizes the resting ECG changes together with a smooth and broad T-wave. When sympathetic stimulation occurs, potassium slow current remains weak due to mutation. As a result, repolarization does not become faster in response to heart rate acceleration. Therefore, corrected QT interval becomes longer. So, the resting ECG in case of congenital long QT syndrome type 1 is characterized by a prolongation of QT interval and especially corrected QT interval, and smooth and broad T wave. The prolongation of repolarization time leads to early after depolarization formation by avoid of L-type calcium channel inactivation mechanism, and therefore prolongation of L-type calcium channel active state in phase 3 of action potential. The full ionic mechanism of early after depolarization formation you can find in another video. Link will be in description. The early after depolarization is represented on ECG by prominent U wave. QT interval also becomes longer. So prominent U wave is signed of early after depolarization. When early after depolarization becomes large enough, it can lead to triggered action potential. On ECG, triggered action potential is represented by early premature ventricular contraction, or PVC. Early means premature ventricular contraction that occurs during the T wave of previous complex. This triggered action potential can provoke additional triggered action potential that is represented by onset of TORSADES depointes, or TDP, on ECG that can be fatal. Usually, TORSADES depointes is initiated by early premature ventricular contraction. Now let's talk about types of triggers in case of long QT syndrome type 1. 75% of fatal events occurs during the exercise, and especially during the swimming and diving. Another 20% occurs during the strong emotion. And the last 10% can be related to sleeping or rest without arousal. So, why is swimming a strong trigger for long QT syndrome type 1 related fatal arrhythmia? On the one hand, it is related to the cold water exposure. On the other hand, it is related to the phase immersion. So, cold water activates cutaneous cold receptors and lead to specific cold shock response that is represented by sympathetic activation and tachycardia. Phase immersion means cold and wet phase and breath hold. This triggers activate specific diving response that is represented by parasympathetic activation and bradycardia. As a result, we have activation of both sympathetic and parasympathetic systems simultaneously, which called autonomic conflict. As we already know that sympathetic stimulation in case of long QT syndrome type 1 lead to fail of repolarization shortening and also increasing calcium current through the L-type calcium channels and increasing of inward direction of sodium-calcium exchanger work. All of these lead to early after depolarization formation and further ventricular arrhythmia. Normally, parasympathetic related bradycardia should be accompanied with a QT prolongation. However, in case of phase immersion, despite this bradycardia, there is no concomitant prolongation of QT interval. This phenomenon called RR-QT hysteresis. This phenomenon may seriously predispose to ventricular arrhythmia during periods of autonomic conflict. Most vulnerable time in aspect of ventricular arrhythmia manifestation during autonomic conflict is time when the heart rhythm changes between tachycardia, sympathetic predominance, to bradycardia, vagal predominance, and within the 10 seconds of the cessation of breath holding. So, autonomic conflict by itself can provoke the ventricular arrhythmia even without concomitant long QT syndrome. But in case of long QT syndrome type 1, probability of ventricular rhythm disorder becomes much higher. The last general aspect of long QT syndrome type 1 is good clinical response to beta blockers. Beta blockers decreases sympathetic stimulation that lead to decreasing of potassium slow channel necessity, and also both calcium and sodium calcium exchange occurrence decreases. As a result, early after depolarization does not occur. Autonomic conflict disappears, and ventricular rhythm disorder occurs much less often. If you like the content, press like, subscribe to our YouTube and Telegram channel, and have a good day! Here we go.